there's that, right?
But there's almost a confirmation bias in science that, and I had this conversation with my brother when he was here, and I was just talking about flying saucers and stuff and concept of them. Sure. And I'm referring to Bob Lazar's, you know, sports car and all that stuff. And like, I've listened to that whole story with Joe Rogan and all that stuff a few times, and, you know, went and tracked down his old interviews and checked it out. And, you know, I don't know if that's
a you read any Richard Dolan? Have you seen his stuff? You got to check out his channel. No. That guy broke the UFO world open.
He just cracked it wide open or something.
It was, well, he basically came at it from a historian's perspective. He was a historian and said, well, I got to choose my next doctorate kind of level paper.
Right.
What am I going to work on? Well, hey, let's look at the history of the secret sort of UFOs.
Because right.
This was a thing in the 40s and 50s. And the military establishment in the US, the Air Force and the military were like, well, what do we do with this? And so he just jumped in. And he was like, oh, there's a lot going on here. And so he said, okay, the nature of his project went like this. He spent years of this. He said, okay, what we're going to do is I'm going to take reports, not from civilians. I'm going to take reports only from police, like emergency workers, military, and Air Force.
Isn't this Project Blue Book though?
That was something else.
Okay.
But this is just this modern project, and he's going to take reports from air traffic controllers, right? People who are obligated to, when they see something weird, they have to take notes, and they're sort of at a level of, you know, like when they're reporting, they have to be as professional as they can
right,
be.
So, right.
And he says he's only going to the only dish that he's going to take reports from. And he's only going to take reports from that dish that have multiple witnesses.
Oh,
so
okay.
It's not just one lone cop out there on the road looking at lights. It's like the cop and then the dispatcher and then someone else over here, all at the level of having to take notes. And so you're going, oh, that's probably a pretty small pile. No, it's hundreds, right? And so, and he just wrote a book documenting them all. Just a whole stack of these things. And they're just like, you start reading through these and you're going, these people can't all be lying or making this stuff up.
Right.
And there's photographic evidence and there's like wire, right. Like, you know, taped evidence. And like, and it's stuff that we, you know, the normal UFO researcher just doesn't know. Anyway, so he collated it all, put it together. And then another element was he was following just anything that has an official memo or letter or something that was signed. You know, he's looking at the documentation available to the public.
Right.
And like Freedom of Information Act kind of stuff. And just put this whole thing together. And it's like, it's enormously compelling. You come away from reading that, you're going, there is 100% something going on. No, it's not the Russians.
It's not
doves in the sky reflecting, it's not, Venus and then he was looking at the official reaction. They're going, well, you know, the military is like, okay, it's clearly something that we can't fight. We can't defend against.
Right.
And the reaction to that is apparently like, well, if we can't do anything about it, we don't want to talk about it because
right.
people are investing their trust in us.
Mm.
How do we proceed? And then you get, you know, incidents where like, well, we have to recover technology and then that goes into this whole other.
And so it could be, put aside what I was going to say though. But no, that's part of all that too, is that there's technologies and things out in the universe that we don't know that even exist, or we have some idea that it exists, but we don't know how it works, like dark matter and antimatter and all that stuff.
Sure.
I don't know anything really about that other than that they somehow can measure it and know it's there. And I don't know what the hell, but they say it's there. Now, does that affect my average day? No. Do I have to believe them? No, I don't. And because they can't prove it to me, I don't have to believe them. But yeah. Here's the thing.
Right.
I said to my brother, I said, what if there was a type of... how did this go? We were talking about propulsion of how these crafts would propel themselves. And he said, you know, his argument was because we couldn't put an answer on it, it can't exist because we can't agree to that field of science, you know? Like back in the 90s, Bob Lazar made a claim that gravity was a wave and not I can't remember how that's phrased. Basically, it was something that could be manipulated through like waves. Like it wasn't just formed by mass. And people were like, no, you're crazy. It's formed by mass. And then I remember when I was in college, upgrading my physics stuff. We were talking about this experiment NASA and MIT and all these guys were doing down in the States to measure and find out if gravity was a wave. And I'm pretty sure they found out it is a wave that can be manipulated. Well,
isn't that one of Einstein's propositions that this gravity waves exist?
I think. Yeah. I don't know all the details about
They're very hard to measure because you got to get two black holes that line up.
Right, but you can manipulate them. And the thing is, Bob Lazar's claim about this propulsion system is that it manipulates gravity. And it also manipulates space and time if it's manipulating gravity in that same way. Hmm. Where does anything in the craft actually take place? Or is it just all on the outside? Like, you know what I mean? Like, you get in the craft, you go for a drive, to you, it's like 0.0 seconds. Right. In reality, in the outside of it, it was years.
Oh, things get super strange. And reading one report, or there's so many accounts, who knows if they're true or not.
But talking to my brother about it, though, he just, because he was brought up by certain ways of science, right? And it, there's so many little things that can't be answered about how this machine would work. He just doesn't believe it can work. Hmm. Right. But that's because he doesn't know how it works. Right. And it's like me in the dark matter. Like, I don't know how dark matter works, but somebody who does can explain it to me better and rationalize the science to me. But unless I can see it in its common place, right. It's like rocket ships.
Right.
Right. In 19, imagine telling people in 1930 that there were going to be rockets going across the continent hitting them, in the 40s, right? Like V2s.
Yeah.
And, or tell them in 25 years from now, somebody's going to go and orbit the planet or something. You know what I mean? It's just like, it's a strange concept.
Yeah. Well, basically people need to fit a concept into their existing framework, right?
Yes, and that's
so
what
here's a great example of that. So there's Graham Bell and his telephone, right?
Right.
And so he's making these reports, like, yeah, I got this lab, and I can do this thing across wires, and we can move sound, and it's really. There was a huge outcry. He was despised by certain segments of the scientific community.
Really?
Who put out, they were like, I remember reading, I saw this great graphic. It was like a scan of some old newspaper coverage. And they said, it was this huge debunking of his claims. And they were saying, look, it's stupid. Because if you had wires, little tubes that thin, and you're moving sound through them, they can't propagate. And by the time they come out the little bell at the other end, because they're thinking like those tubes on ships where you talk in one end in it. And so they assumed it fit into that sandbox, proved that it was nonsense, and called him a charlatan, they're trying to like blackball the guy. And luckily he was in that position where, like, they're going to say, well, if it's real, prove it, show it. And he was in a position where he could.
Right.
But I think, you hear certain stories about people, they can, but they just vanish sometimes. Yeah. Or they go into mental institutions if they get too close to the magic battery or whatever,
But that's exactly kind of what that's progress, right? Like him going against those people and saying, no, you guys are the crazy ones. And you 98% of people out there, you're crazy, stupid people. This is how we're going to do it.
And we never learn. Like, we're seeing the same thing with Tesla. He's like, I think we can do electric, solar panels. There's this huge push. It's like, old oil interests propagandizing. But then there's like just regular people who, like, they've figured out this is how the world works. This is where I'm comfortable. I'm a retiree and this is how the world. And saying, well, solar panels is no.
Yeah.
Why? Because it rubs my brain the wrong way
and it must be wrong. And there's
all these, there's compelling arguments that can be made against, but luckily you have people like Musk who was able to navigate that and just go, well, screw you, I'm doing it anyway.
Exactly. And I'm so glad he does everything he does because he's an inspiration to.
Did you know there's only one supercharger in Nova Scotia?